Hello.
Oh my God, we're alive and
Live.
we have a guest today who just swam in Maine waters and lived to tell the tale. I cannot believe it. Please welcome Carrie Morgan. Woo! Yay! Now,
Yay.
of course, Kathy Ferris is here. She has her wonderful Ferris and Friends every Wednesday night
Thanks
at
for the plug.
8 o'clock. You bet. Anytime. Anything for my girlfriends. Anyway, Karen, like, we're so pleased to have you. Well, let me. For people who don't know her, and probably most of you do, but anyway, she is an excellent trial attorney and an even better comedian. Okay. We were glad when she jumped over. But you know, that's the performing arts, right? The trial attorneys are the performers, right?
Exactly. No, you're just the difference is you're standing in front of a jury instead of standing in front of drunk people listening to jokes, but you're
Right. I
still.
think the difference is you make money as a trial attorney.
Yes. No, that is for sure. Hopefully you make money as a trial attorney. You shouldn't be
But
doing it anymore.
anyway, you're doing so much right now. I mean, I know you'd been executive director of the Nantucket Comedy Festival. You got the Law and Disorder podcast, and oh, Comedy with Class. You're probably going on the road with them. So
Well,
just
on the road.
and the, oh, sorry, I want you to talk about all these. This COVID's making me really.
Jane's only had four Diet Cokes right now.
I'll try to bring it back. I actually was excited because I just was rewatching one of your dry bar things. Karen, did you know it's up to 151,000 views?
What? No, I did
Wow.
not.
Yeah, it's
Good.
so good. It's
Yay.
really good.
That's, and I think you have three of them up. But anyway, I was there about the lady in her 80s who goes to the gym or something, but she doesn't know enough to wear a towel.
The towel lady, yeah.
Which is a great bit, but it brings me to, it made me think of, let's talk some about clean comedy. Like,
Sure.
not only are the three of us moms, but we belong to that even smaller subset called clean comedy. And it's not easy. So what are
Yeah.
your thoughts about it?
Well, my thoughts are that my stuff generally was clean before. I'm not a prude. I can swear like a sailor and ask my kids, I do. But in terms of the comedy medium, I find that I do so much corporate work and things like that, that it just made sense to, as I was writing more and more material, to say, hey, you know, if this is totally clean, I can use it in more places.
That's, yeah, very good. Very good. Kathy, what made you go down the clean road?
Honestly, it really was just that I didn't think anybody, I don't want to talk about it, and I didn't think people wanted to hear from me about it. I mean, that's not to say that people who do it shouldn't do it. I think, great.
There's room for all of
I
us.
like a funny structured joke, but it was just more of that wasn't where my material was coming from.
Yeah, I think that's the right. We're talking before we went on air about a certain comedian was doing pussy, 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 pussy. And you know, we have to follow those people sometimes. So I've learned to say, I live in Connecticut where a pussy is still a small cat. And that generally gets, so now it's like, please come back to me. We're going on a different ride. But I do believe it takes longer if you're a clean comic. I agree with you, Karen, that we have more opportunities. You know, you can do the country clubs, you can do the corporates, but it just takes longer.
It does. I usually if I have new comics ask me any advice, that is probably the biggest piece of advice I say. If you have a preference and you don't feel like you need to be dirty for your personality, because you should always be yourself. No, number one rule of comedy, be who
100%.
you are.
100%.
You know, be who you are. Don't change yourself because people will know it's not you. But if you are comfortable being a clean comic anyway, then spend your time writing that material because that will, if you ever want to get paid, you know,
Right.
if you ever
Just
want to get paid,
go for
that's
it.
where there are more budgets in terms of clean comedy.
I agree. You know, like anytime people are starting out, I feel like one of the things that happens is they start writing to like, what do people want me to talk about? Instead of like, what do I want to talk about?
Very good advice.
And the other part is that, right, when you're clean, you can get more opportunities because people aren't. They don't have to edit you and you don't have to shift around. You just got your stuff.
Yeah.
And also, there are ways to shift your words in a certain situation. If you're in a club, you can say it a little more edgy and you can just nuance it. It
Yeah.
doesn't take much to downshift, you know?
It doesn't.
Or you can just, you can you have the bit in this 151,000 views, I'm totally envious, of the lady who doesn't wear her towel. Now, we all know that translates to she's naked, okay? But you're not hitting them over the head with it. It's like, right. Let them fill in the blank.
Right. And I do, in the past, I have had jokes that had a swear. And then I had a couple of jokes that I had that the swear was actually the punch, and it wasn't a mm-hmm. big swear. It was a swear for me. But then I found if I needed to try to take that swear out, the joke just didn't work. Right. So it didn't land the same way. So I stopped writing those jokes because I'm like that, if I have a great joke, but I can't take it to this really cool venue that I want to do, but they want me to be clean. So I stopped writing the ones that really depended on a swear as the punch.
Yeah. Well, it is an easy laugh, you know, especially coming from these three faces.
Yeah.
They go, whoa.
Yeah.
Well, it is nice to have in your back pocket, though, just to like, you know, in a 40-minute set, be able to drop an F-bomb, you know, like where they're not expecting it. But I agree with you. I have this one joke that like, I wish I could find another word for it. Where I say, for Mother's Day, I got a paint tonight gift certificate, which is just like another way of saying, make your own gift, bitch.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, I want to say something, like sometimes I try to put something else in, but I agree with you, like nothing punches better than that.
Yeah,
it's true. You could lose 30% of that joke if you just landed on make your own gift. Like you put bitch into your tone or the F word into your tone or into your attitude. I just find like I'm saying it in my head so I can deliver it with that. But it's really
you mouth it.
Yeah.
Oh well, or I swallow or effing or friggin'. I'm so sick of all those little but
can we talk about one of Karen's jokes that I really love, which is the Marie Kondo one.
Oh. you guys will laugh at this. I actually have the book sitting here because I was writing a joke and I was actually going through this book. There it is. Here's the dumb book.
Wow.
Does this spark joy, Karen?
Does this spark joy?
Yeah. I love that book. I thought it was very interesting.
The Swedish death cleaning one actually was funnier to read to me. The concept of Swedish death, the fact that death is in the title just made me laugh. As a Southerner, we love death and funerals anyway, but Swedish death cleaning was just, I'm like, and I bought the book and actually it was helpful. I'm like, my kids don't want all this crap when I go. So I'm getting rid of it now. They can't have it ever. So
how long have you been in Maine? I know you went to school down in Georgia and law school, but how long have you been in Maine?
24 years. I met my husband in Maine on a blind date. And
wow.
Yeah, I was practicing law in Atlanta and my aunt and uncle set me up with him. He was building their house up here in Maine. And for 2 years, they tried to set me up with him. And for 2 years, I was like, I'm not that desperate to have to go to Maine for a date. And then I guess I was, so I did. And then,
lifetime movie, Karen. I love it.
Or maybe they just kept him building the house. Like, we need another bedroom till we get her up here. You know,
the funny thing, when you hear him tell his side of the story was like, he really wanted the job to build their house. He needed the work. And they're like, where are you going to be on September 21st of next year? Our niece is coming to visit. And he's like, what horrible person could this be that I have to go out with her because she's coming all the way here. So he took the date, but anyway, it worked out. And I moved up right here 6 months after I met him. So it was very fast. So
pretty much love at first sight or love in the first couple of months.
I like it. I love stories like that.
Wow, how brave are you? You weren't worried about a culture change?
Well, if you sit in Atlanta traffic long enough, you're kind of ready. But I actually also thought I would come up here. And then if I didn't like it, I would talk him into moving back down south with me. Like I was like, I'll just pretend to like Maine and, it'll be fine. But then I turned out I really liked it. And it's, the culture here, everybody's just very nice and they're open and they're just really nice people here. And it's been a great place to raise my kids.
That's what I was going to say. I think it's a great place to have kids.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And my kids are Mainers.
The other thing that I think is interesting about your career is, you're not in Boston, you're not in New York, you're not in LA, and yet you're a successful comedian. How'd you do it?
I think what it is the industry is so interesting. I'm still in this industry because I love it. I love
Oh, we're addicted too.
Yeah, yeah. We're all sort of addicted. And I like the business aspect of it. And I think with touring with the Mama's Night Out group, when we did that, I learned, wow, this is a whole nother area of industry I didn't even know existed.
Right.
You know, I didn't even know that, you know, these theater shows were a thing. And I'm like, oh, this is a cool thing. So I learned that through that you can do national stuff from home. Because when I stopped practicing law, which was after my daughter was born, you know, I made a conscious decision to stay home with my kids. So then a few years later, I found comedy literally to get out of the house. But, you know, it took me on the road, which was taking me away from my kids. So I'm like, okay, how do I balance this and still raise kind human beings? You know, not being home is hard to do. So I figured if I can do this by being home-based, I'll still continue to do it. And I've been able to just by, you know, and now what we're doing here, you know,
we're all home-based now.
Yeah, exactly. So we're all rediscovering, you know, what we can do from our house, which I got to tell you, I'm an extroverted introvert. I kind of like it in a way, you know, I miss the being on stage in front of big audiences, but I don't miss traveling. I don't miss the airport. I don't miss rental cars. If I can do stuff from here, I'm super happy about it.
I do. And I think you are such an inspiration though, Karen, because that's exactly where, you know, for somebody like me, I've been doing it 8 years, and to know like how you did this, where it's always this question of like New York or LA, New York or LA. It's like, no, Medfield, I want to stay married. But what can I do from here? And when looking at you, even online, your online presence, you're just everywhere. You're just everywhere, and you're landing these big things, and you're doing what you're doing. And it's really an inspiration.
I'm everywhere, but I'm really just here.
Yeah, which is great, right?
Like I did swim with my friend this morning, you know, and I have this little home base, and I'm, you know, my kids are, I have 3 college age kids, and they're obviously all home right now. And some will go back in the fall and some will not go back in the fall.
It's fine.
Yeah, we're trying to figure that out. I was supposed to have all 3 at college in the fall, and that's not happening.
I hear you. There go the empty nester jokes until you get them.
But I've established this really good group of friends that are not in comedy, as you know. I've got comedy friends, you know, and then I've got my swimming friends. But most of it is based around the house until I feel like my kids are grown and to the point of, I don't need to. My mom used to say, when the older they get, the, you know, bigger the kid, the bigger the problems.
Yeah. Oh, I'm with you, mom. But yeah. Never
mind. What do you think that is, Karen? Do you think it's like, because I have a 21, 24 year old too, and I'm thinking,
yeah.
At first I was like 24. Yeah. Now I'm thinking maybe 32. Like what is this? Like,
is it a 24 year old, a boy or a girl?
A girl.
A girl. Yeah. Cause they still need us, you know, mm-hmm. It doesn't matter, you know, and they could be away and still need us at the same time, but I'm not one of these people like, get out of my house. I'm kind of like embracing the fact that they're home and that although we all don't like the reason that we're all stuck at home, obviously, mm-hmm. It has created a weird little bubble this spring that I'm like, you know, I don't know when this is going to happen again, that they're all supposed to be home together with me.
I'm with my kids now. We just joined them like 2 weeks ago. We just finished getting out of quarantine. We drove from Connecticut to Massachusetts, to Nantucket. And we just broke quarantine on Monday, which was great. And
break quarantine. I like that. I'm breaking quarantine.
Oh, no.
That sounds like a really good Netflix special.
I went to the Garden Center, Bartlett's, you may know.
Yeah.
Because they have senior hours from 7 to 8. There were only 3 of us. And I I was really kind of offended because they didn't card me. I was just waving my little driver's license, like, do you want to see my license? No.
They're all good. It's all good.
So that was a sadness. But I think the saying your mom may be referring to, or at least how I wrote it in my mind a long time ago, is little kids, little problems, big kids, drinking problems. I think I added that one, the drinking. But you know, right now, our kids are in, our 2 boys are in their 30s and the girls are here. And they wouldn't spend a month with us now, you know,
unless this. Yeah.
And it is kind of a precious time. And the other thing, I mean, I hate to be like a Pollyanna, but, you know, my husband's a real businessman, and he was just entranced with this robin's nest outside his study window. And he kept watching, and I never saw the damn birds. And he said, they're here, you know, the little beeps are up. And they're like, who are you?
And then, can it smell then, the roses?
Who's inhabited my husband's body?
Yeah.
I actually had like 1 year of training ahead of the pandemic couples. Do you know, he was already home for a year because we were empty nesters. And it was, anyway, I have a lot of jokes about that. I'm not going to bore you with them. But the, oh, so the comedy with class, did you already start touring with that? Or did that happen like right when the pandemic?
It literally happened like the first part of March. So it happened and we're still, we're planning on some different tours right now. And so it's been kind of nice because I'm home planning production stuff for these tours. And I'm planning production stuff on tours that I'm on and that other people are on. So I'm working with them. Because I've got the experience in the production side of things and the experience in the touring with performing arts centers. But the reality is, you know, no one's buying shows right now and they're not going to be buying shows for a while. So, well,
yeah, I supposedly have a theater September 10th, which I'm like, what are these people, crazy?
Yeah.
I have one next March in Modesto, California. And I have a little hope for that.
Yeah.
Do either of you have any idea timeline? I you know, vaccine, but when is that?
And
yeah, I've got an April gig next year, but
that. I have penciled in December, March of next year. But in the meantime, what I'm trying to do is not pivot, but sort of embrace sitting in this office chair. Like, you know, it's not a well-adjusted person,
Kathy. This, you know, is what a well-adjusted person looks like.
Where, you know, what are we going to do? So I'm having to learn how to Zoom, and I'm having to learn how to record a Zoom call. Jim and I are going to be doing these game shows on Zoom.
Oh, tell us about that. I saw the logo. It was so cute. Happily Ever Laughter.
So, awesome. And this is just an example of the fact that this is from our live show that we tour with. We normally do this in theaters. Our theater show is called Lawn and Disorder. It's me and Jim. Jim is from Boston. We are not married. He does the dad and the husband stuff. I do the mom stuff.
Right.
And then interim in the show, we have a game show with couples, and we bring two couples on stage that we ask for volunteers. We have no idea who we're going to get. You know, we don't know how it's going to go. It's bananas. It's really cute, but we try to get people that have been married for a long time. And then we ask them questions that they really should both know if they've been married long, and then they never know.
They never.
You're not trying to trick them. I know. Yeah.
No, it is. And it's really cute. So, but we normally are doing this on the road. So now that we're not able to do this on the road, this is one of the things that you can do from home. So we're going to try it on Zoom, and we're going to get two couples, and he and I are going to host it from our separate houses.
Yeah.
The couples are going to be in their separate houses.
I love it.
I don't know how we're going to get them to not cheat, except for they're going to have to, you know, normally on stage, we have the men on one side and the ladies on the other. So they're far apart from each other. So the couples will be sitting, obviously.
Why don't you just put them in their separate bedrooms? Because everybody sleeps in different bedrooms.
Everyone sleeps well in different bedrooms.
Right.
There you go. Well said. I said, I have been awake since 1978 with my husband snoring. It's just,
Mine is terrible.
I
think you bring up a good point. You know, this is something that Kat says to, you know, being with, connected with Wise Her now too, is like, you're your own advocate, and you've got to make your own things. And like, so you did this yourself. You put the show together, you produce it, and you before the pandemic.
Right. Yeah. So I actually, because I toured, my background is starting out with Nick at Night was like my first thing. Mm-hmm. When I was first, that literally was like my graduation comedy show, and then Nick at Night. And, Christine and I were on the same season of Nick at Night. It was Christine, me, Sherry, Nancy Witter.
Oh, wow.
You know, so there were seven of us. And so after that was over with, I was watching the Blue Collar Comedy Tour, and I was like, okay, we need to do a Blue Collar Comedy Tour for moms.
Great.
And ultimately I had met Nancy and Sherry. So I said, would you guys like to go do this? So we created this show. I had no idea what I was doing. No, like less than an, and I, that probably is why it worked, because I didn't know what I was doing. And so I didn't know, like, this should be hard. And it was hard, but we did it for 5 years. Wow. And then when we stopped doing it, I still wanted to do something. And somebody said, well, why don't you do something with a guy? Cause there's always the date night thing is a big draw. We need, you know, and it needs to be clean. And so I had gone for 5 years in these venues that need clean comedy. And then, so Jim Roach introduced me to Jim Colleton. And so Jim and I, so I started writing the show with Jim. So yeah, Kathy, I think you're right. We are all capable of just creating stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm in the mode of, I listen to my dad's voice tell me, you know, if you don't ask, they can't tell you no. So just keep, you know.
I'm probably in the back here clapping, like, yes, this is what she says all the time. Yeah.
Making your own opportunity.
Yes, I am.
You got to pivot or die.
Yeah.
You can. I do have friends who say, like, we're going to do these 5 to 7 minute shows. And I'm there like, because I'm an athlete. I got to get out there.
No, I think the same mentality that you have, like, not my kid, you know, like this advocate that you're for your kid, but for yourself being like, no, I can do this. Like, give me a shot. This is what we're going
to
do.
And I was reluctant. I was very reluctant to do shows from here, you know, because I'm like, it's not going to be the same. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not going to have the same energy. And so, and I think what I have done now is I'm embracing that it's not going to be the same. So let's create something that's not the same, but is still, you know, using our heads to create and write and, you know, do something, whether it's videos or whatever. I joined TikTok for like half an hour. And
me too.
What did you guys think? I mean,
how many times are you up at 2 a.m. being like, I could do this?
I did it. I was like, and I'm still on it at 2 a.m. And it's funny. It really is very funny and it's very entertaining. And I got sucked in like everybody else did. And I did a few of them. But then I ultimately realized, okay, business wise in the comedy industry, where is this going for me personally? Because there were some really good people that are on TikTok, but they do like 2 and 3 a day.
Whoa.
And I'm like,
whoa,
I don't have that time. You know,
I just
don't. I think it's a great medium. And I also think, well, okay, is it something that's going to eventually lead to a ticket sale? I don't know, you know, so I try to do the next step ahead of where's this going to lead to.
That's really smart. Okay.
That's good advice because it's true because I think everybody got sucked into, especially at the beginning of the pandemic where it's like, what is this thing? And then you're like, oh, wait a minute, this could be productive and wonderful. And then you're thinking, didn't you always feel hesitant? Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, mine are out there. I'm not real proud of them, but they're out there. But I think you're right, Kathy. What we did was we were all stuck at home and it was a very great distraction for that period of time when we were first stuck at home and everybody was scared and you just needed literally some break from Twitter of, you know, everyone's going to die, you know. Okay, I go to TikTok. These people are dancing. This is a whole lot more fun.
Right.
I had a toilet paper challenge, how many rolls you could put on your head. I mean, I mean, desperate times.
Did you do that on TikTok, Jane?
No, I didn't do it on TikTok.
I'm surprised.
I just did it on my Facebook thing. I had a couple of them. I did one making my bra into a face mask. This was way back. And
way back, like 6 weeks ago.
I know. Olden days of our pandemic.
It feels like 1986. Can I ask Karen another question? I don't mean to like jump in. Karen, so when are you going to be doing this show, that show, the Lana?
The Happily Ever Laughter, the game show?
Yeah.
The first one is scheduled for July 22nd. So what we're doing right now is the Comedy with Class people are collecting people. People are signing up to have a chance to be on the game show. They collect all the names and addresses of people that want to be on it. So we could have people from, I don't know, Texas or Ohio.
Well, that's a great part of the pandemic too, is like I've been on West Coast shows. That's wonderful.
Yeah. So,
you know, except it's late for me. It's 15 and they're like, whoa.
But the first one is scheduled for July 22nd. I don't know if we're going to do the first one live or not, to be quite honest, because I think we kind of need to get the logistics figured out. We'll definitely tape it and then post it. But I'm hoping
like it'd make a great TV show. You know, once this is over, because I love what you said. First of all, embrace the pandemic and think about the next step. That's really smart thinking. you know, that can you convert it into something? And I mean, for us, 4 o'clock funnies was just the wonderful Catherine Rose you met before the show.
Yeah.
She just said, we're on an online women's group together, women in tech, media, and finance. And she'd started this whole women empowerment thing. We were just chatting and she said, I need to laugh, Jane. If I don't, I'm going to start reading a joke book online. And they're like, whoa. I have some friends, Kat.
No, right? But I think this is such a brilliant format that you guys are doing here, because it allows a lot of things. It allows everybody to laugh, you know, it allows people to get together. It allows people to be informed, but mostly it allows people to know they're not alone. And I think that is a big thing right now, is that just.
Yeah, I think you got to hire Karen as a comedy coach.
Yeah, man.
So much. I didn't know you know all this.
I feel like we were scripted today. We felt so polished. I do think that I've been trying to pitch to Kat that we have some kind of like, we do this hunter killer thing, you know, where we have the fictional, we go hunt a fictional murder. And Karen has to be on the team because she's got all this background.
I'll do it. I want to catch people murdering. I want to do it.
I'm going to be eating Fig Newtons and not anywhere near you people.
We're catching murderers.
Yeah, I'm going to connect with you.
You and Kelly McFarland, they are.
We're going to build this team.
What's wrong in Connecticut?
Do it.
I'm like anti-murder down there. I don't know.
We're going to be part-time comedians, part-time sleuths.
We're sleuths.
Yes.
Nancy Drew, was old reference, but anyway.
Crime stoppers. Crime stoppers.
I like crime stoppers.
Crime stoppers.
Don't you think? I think women could be serial killers. It's just we don't have time. It's like 98.
Yeah. We are serial killers. We just know how to cover our tracks, okay?
Yeah.
Okay. There you go. That was really fun. Thank you. We do not. I do remember, you know, when I found out 98% of serial killers were men, I remember trying to think it through and maybe try and get a joke out of it. And I couldn't really, but I got as far as, I mean, who wants to go to Costco and you got to get body bags, and you got the saws, you got the knives, you got to have a
shot. And while you're there, you get mayonnaise and mustard and, you know,
yeah, mayonnaise. And you're like, do you concentrate on what you can kill with, or do you get the mayonnaise and mustard?
First of all, that's the rookie mistake. You don't go to Costco or Walmart where they can see the surveillance. You send your husband. You're already setting him up.
You've already gotten crime stopped.
You are good, Kathy. I must
say. Well, Karen,
that's a professional. My dad was FBI, so like I do try to think ahead of, you know, how to cover your tracks. I shouldn't say this online. Okay. I'm just kidding. Cover your tracks, ladies. Okay. Send in your husband. That was really.
Well, I did have the walking group. I did add serial killers in my walking group bit. That, you know, women have walking groups so we don't kill people. That's why we have walking groups.
That's brilliant.
And this is why serial killers are always men, because they don't have a walking group.
This is what I love about your comedy, though, Karen, because, like as a comedian, I don't like you when I'm watching it, because I'm like, this is so obvious and so simplistic, but the way you say it,
yeah,
it's like, of course.
Well, and then she says it with that Southern accent, and then she really wins. You
that's
know?
Why she gets all these applause.
I'm in my walking group, and I'm not killing anybody. It's funnier than my saying, I'm in a walking group, I am not hurting anybody.
But that's what's so, to me, that is what's so fun about comedy, because you watch people, and I watch people who narrow down a focus of something. Like Brian Regan is one of my favorite people to watch.
Me too.
It is a very minute little, whatever the subject is, you know, it's so minute, and he narrows down on it and you're like, okay, I know this, but you're narrowing down on this thing. It's just brilliant. So I love the process of watching other people and how they write. He had this thing about going to Disney World and he was with his kids and they were standing in line. And the people behind them, you know how you're stuck in the queue and these people are trying to get in front,
yeah,
you know? And so and he and his kids are trying to keep these people from cutting in line. And finally he goes, I just wanted to go over to the guy and say, and just take his wallet and just throw it and just say, hey, isn't this what you want? Anarchy. And just, you know, and it was just just a little tiny observation that he blew up into this really big thing. And then I'm like, okay, that how do you do that? And so I think that my material obviously comes from being at home with the kids and, you know, family stuff, but I, that's the only way I'm going to get material is that I got to do it. Cause I'm not an actress person. I know there's really great people that can act out. So it has to happen to me for me to make it be real enough to do it into a bit.
What I like too about your comedy is that, I love that you do stories. When I was starting out, I did stories and all that. No, it's set up punch. But I think honestly, comedy's kind of evolved. And like, you can do a story now, but within it, you got to have a certain amount of laughs per minute. That's all.
Right.
But I love a story because they get on your ride and they're comfortable and they're trusting. Yeah, and then you take a left turn or whatever. But it's, when I saw that you were matched up with Jean Robertson, mm-hmm. I've watched her a long time because she can do the stories. I'm very intrigued always by the story people. And it's just... you know, she has her own thing, but like you have your version of it. I can see why your match is what
it took a while actually to, you know, when you start out, it took a while to, part of this too is Southern. It you know, we're right. storytellers. Right. That's how we sort of.
Oh, right. Grew up.
So, right. but then you start learning comedy and then you learn from someone, you got to have a setup punch and a setup punch. And then I tried, that just did not work for me. It just didn't. So I think the longer that we do this business, and as y'all know, y'all have both been in it for a very long time, you become who you are and you become comfortable with who you are. And you're like, okay, this works for me. It may not work for, you know, Tom Cotter is a brilliant setup punch, quick.
Rat-a-tap-tap.
You got to lean forward and go, you know, Stephen Wright, you got to lean forward and make sure you're on for the ride. You know, my style's not going to be like them. I think the older I've gotten, and I think this is as an older female too, or getting older female, is that at some point you are who you are, you embrace who you are.
Yeah.
And it makes you more comfortable.
They told us all this earlier because I think I think that the most challenging part of comedy, I didn't want to say hard, is finding your persona, finding your voice. And if people had just said to me, it's okay to be you, Jane, maybe plus 10%, you know, a little energy, a few Diet Cokes. But, you know, because we all go around Robin Hood's barn, like, you know, I tried a little Rita Rudner, but I don't dress as well. And, you know, Wanda Sykes, I'm not National Security Council or whatever she did. And, you know, you try a little bit of all, I'm not as pushy as Joan Rivers, but I have to tell you, when I saw Joan Rivers, what an inspiration. I saw her twice live, no, three times, I guess, once in a big theater. That's a thing. But I saw her twice in smaller venues in New York, like in the duplex upstairs. That's a 70 seat thing. And she was just charging around the stage and her physicality, her energy. I mean, like, oh, I got to ratchet it up. I get it. You know, and it's just, it's so wonderful when we see, on the other hand, Lily Tomlin is a hero of mine, total story.
Yeah.
You know.
What I like about you, Karen, though, is that, you know, people come into this where like, oh, I'm a storyteller or I'm a joke writer. And you have this really great hybrid of this.
Yeah.
Because you're able to set up a joke and then you do it. But then you do it in this like conversational kind of way. That's like, we're in the room with you, but you're doing an act out, but it's like written like a setup punch. So that's what I like about it. Cause to me, like that translates for me.
Thank you.
Where I'm not a storyteller. And I do like the setup punch thing, but
thanks.
I think there's something else there.
I think it's okay that as we're learning, this maybe go out to younger comics and particularly younger female comics. If you're out there learning, it's okay to try on different hats. Mm-hmm. You know, it's okay to try. I'm going to try on the fireman hat today. And then you realize I am not a fireman. And then, you know, it's okay. You know, forgive yourself for trying to be a fireman. That's okay. You at least gave it a shot. Try being a policeman now, you know, it's okay because in order to find out who you are, what your most comfortable fit is, you've got to try them all out. And
I think I had about a 2 week blue period.
Blue. Really? Oh, I don't see you as being blue.
You know, like you in my real life, I can, you know, sling it, but not in front of.
Yeah, I kind of want to see that too, Karen. I want to see her.
It was very limited.
Jane Condon's blue album. We want to see it. We want to hear it.
You might see Jane Condon the lavender album. It's going to be
a colonial blue.
Before we go, what other color comics do we like? Like, I'm so Gaffigan, Brian Reagan. Did you work with Jeff Foxworthy? I'm just saying because you're both Southern.
Yeah, no, I've done a couple things with him, and he's by the way, is super, super sweet, like just good human being. Jane, you knew Vic Henley. Vic Henley was a very close friend of mine. Vic passed away in April, but we did a Zoom funeral for Vic, and Jeff was on there, and we all spoke, and it was a small sort of family thing. Jeff spoke, Ron White was on there, Kathleen Madigan, who I adore.
Oh, well, yeah, she's probably my number one female favorite. Yeah. She was one of my judges on Last Comic Standing.
Oh, she's just one. And Vic and Kathleen were very, very close friends too. So, what I like about this business, like, you know, meeting and working with people like this is when you finally meet them and they're way up here and they're still such nice, good human beings. You're like, oh, okay, the world is okay. You know, I'm gonna survive. And then, but then you meet somebody that's like down here, and then they're an asshole to you, and you're like,
I divide comedians into two groups: the neurotics and the psychotics. And like, the neurotics, I enjoy.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I don't do psychotics anymore. It's too much effort. I'm not asking to be perfectly balanced. Just you know, not off the. Don't be mean.
I think that's the bottom line. And that was one thing that Vic always said to me. I said, Vic, everybody knows you and everybody likes you so much. He says, that's because I'm nice to everybody. And, you know, he was nice and kind and giving to every person, no matter what level where they were.
Yeah.
And I think there's some people like Jeff Foxworthy or Dan Whitney, who is Larry the Cable Guy, that they, you know, they have achieved a certain stature, so they don't have to, you know.
Right.
But I went to Dan's house and he and I unloaded the dishwasher together. And I'm like, okay, this is weird, but this is so wonderful. I feel so good about humanity right now that Larry the Cable Guy unloads his own dishwasher. You know? So then when I am confronted with this other people that are less than kind,
yes,
I'm thinking, you know what? I just don't need this. And, yeah. And you know,
I also say, go to the love. Whether it's the audience or your fellow comedians, because life is short.
It is. Yeah.
You know, and anyway, I just want to tell you one expression Kathy has that I really like. It's so small, but I know you liked a little.
Anyway, I'm worried.
Don't worry. You said it the other day about chasing the joke. Like when she's writing a new joke, she talks about chasing the joke, and they're like, "That is exactly what I do. I'm chasing the joke."
What, like to get where it's going, or?
Well, we were just talking about comedy in general, and we were talking about doing something. I'm like, listen, you know, if you think about it, like we're both in this. Like when you're chasing the joke, that's when you feel like all this joy, because you're like, you know, you're on to something, and. You know, you walk around with it all day. Like that's the high that.
I love that expression because you're right. It gives you, it's like when you have new material, you're kind of excited. It may not be your top. It may not be where it's going to be eventually. It may be polished a lot better, different, but when it's new and it's exciting to you, I love that expression, Kathy. That's great.
Yeah, that's the best feeling.
I just thought that was really great. I mentioned it to, I do a little podcast called Funny Over 50, and Brian Kiley, I was in LA visiting.
Oh, I love him. He's sweet.
He's such a master craftsman. At the end, I realized,
brilliant.
He talked about Conan, and then I realized, you know what's great about that is I showed respect to the man for his craft. It's like we didn't even need to puff it up with that.
Right.
He has so much knowledge in his head. Yeah. And what was it? He said, you know, when I do a joke for Conan and it works, it's like, oh, great. When I do a joke for me and it works, and they're like, ah!
Yeah.
You know,
and Brian is one of those people in the industry that is a great example of super kind and super talented and super intelligent and also super humble. You know,
oh, yeah.
You meet him, you know, you don't know he's the head writer for Conan. He would never tell you that. He would never tell you that.
I know. It's just, well, okay. So let's end the show by saying new comedians, be super kind, super nice, and super funny. You know, you got to be super funny at some point.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's okay. I think maybe what I would say is it's okay to be kind. You know, it's okay to, you know, obviously, and maybe this goes out to female comedians as well. We all know we have maybe a little bit of an extra hurdle some days. But pull up your fellow female comedian, you know, grab her by the hand, ask her, you know, hey, you want to have coffee, you know, let's chat. Cause I think the more camaraderie that we have, the more calming it is. Like, okay, I'm not by myself trying to get to this business.
I feel better, Kathy. Do you feel better?
I love that.
This wasn't entirely what I was expecting, but you have
more. I have to say, usually when we have a guest on, I get a little nervous because I'm like, okay, like, what is this? Because sometimes it can be intimidating. And this was just lovely. And I feel like you and I got to start
talking. Thanks, Karen.
Kathy, I feel bad we've never met before. We have the same, almost the same glasses.
I know.
We've got to go solve murders together. Let's do that.
Yes.
I'll tape it. I got nothing to do with this. Anyway, we really appreciate you coming on, Karen.
My pleasure.
And tell us when Happily Ever Laughter comes out. We'll push it out on social media.
Would be great.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll figure out if I can figure out how to record, hit the record button and make it save.
We're all learning that.
We're all learning.
Okay, have a great weekend. Happy 4th. It's my mother's birthday on the 4th of July. She always said, everybody celebrates my birthday, which I
love. Oh, happy birthday. Oh,
happy birthday.
Bye-bye, guys.
America.
Bye.